The story began here in the Austrian town of Braunau, with a child born in this house, Adolf Hitler.
At his peak, the most popular ruler in Europe. The child born here in Braunau belonged to that handful of human beings who have clearly and decisively changed the history of the 20th century.
Linz, Austria, the site of the only memorial to the Hitler family, the grave of Hitler's parents. Nothing about his parents or Adolf's early life gave any hint of the extraordinary career that was to come. His father, Alois, was a stern, short-tempered customs official who beat his son. His mother, Clara, tried to protect him. When she died, young Adolf was broken by grief. He kept her portrait with him for the rest of his life. The infant Adolf was baptized and brought up as a Catholic. At the age of 6, he entered the monastery school at Lambach. Soon, he was top of his class. Hitler was a chorister at the great Abbey Church of Lambach. "I used," he said, "to intoxicate myself with the solemn splendor of the services." Every day when he sang in the choir, he saw the memorial to an earlier abbot. Above it was an emblem which a quarter of a century later, Hitler was to adopt for the Nazi party, the swastika. In his teens, Hitler became a moody adolescent. At secondary school in Linz, he lost interest in most of his work. His ambition was to go to Vienna and become an artist or architect. Once there, he produced architectural drawings and watercolors like these. Competent, but not good enough to win the place he longed for at the Viennese Academy of Fine Arts.
Little by little, all Hitler's early ambitions in Vienna turned sour. After the shock of being turned down twice by the Academy of Fine Arts, he became a drifter. Hitler later called his period in Vienna the most miserable time of my life. 3 of those miserable years were spent here in a Viennese backstreet at this hostel for homeless men.
In this depressing hostel, the future Führer passed much of the day sitting with other inmates, churning out drawings and watercolors which earned him a modest income. When he drifted from Vienna to Germany in 1913, he was still dreaming of becoming a great artist or famous architect. Munich, the 1st of August, 1914. A cheering crowd welcomes the outbreak of the First World War. On the right is a photographer, and among the crowd he's photographing is the 25-year-old Adolf Hitler.
If you look at the tenacity of his service, I mean, he's a fanatic. And he petitioned King Ludwig III of Bavaria to enlist in what's referred to as the King's Own Regiment. That's an elite Bavarian unit. He was accepted, but put in the 16th Bavarian Reserve Infantry. And World War I is a major influence on Hitler's life. Now, he served his basic training without complaining, but he was always willing to offer his fellow comrades help. He spoke about the evil of tobacco and alcohol to his fellow soldiers. They liked him because of his drawings that he did for them. He would do sketches for them. Remember, he sketched and did a variety of things, you know, in his youth, and was trying to get into art school. So he really got along with his fellow soldiers. At one point during the trench duties in between 14 and 18, he will have a dog. Somebody's going to steal from him. During World War I, Adolf Hitler repeatedly volunteered for hazardous duty. His first combat was October the 29th, 1914. Hitler's unit lost 3,000 of its 3,600 men after making 5 assaults on the enemy position. Now, Hitler had one of his sleeves shot off. He walked out of a tent where he'd been talking with some men, and a couple of seconds later, a shell hits and blows at the Kingdom Come. And for his fighting in this unit, he was awarded the Iron Cross Second Class for bravery under fire, and he was promoted to corporal. This is a well-deserved award. Later, he became a runner, which meant he moved messages from the rear to the front, and it's a very high mortality job, and he liked it. He always liked that job. Then in December of 1914, when you have the famous Christmas truce on December the 25th, Hitler wouldn't leave his trench. And his comment was, such a thing should not happen in wartime. And then he told his buddies that participated that they were wrong to get involved. So, no fun while the war goes on. Those are your enemies. Now, between 1914 and 1916, in the final stages of the Battle of the Somme, Adolf Hitler was wounded in the leg by a shell fragment. This sent him back to Germany to recover. And he's there for about 5 months. Hitler could have stayed back in Germany on light duty because of his wound, but demanded to be sent back to the front. So he's no shirker. You've got to give a guy some due here for not being a chicken. A lot of people, you know, look for a way to get out of there. Then you have Hitler back again on trench duty. And then he shows up again during the, of course, German offensives. Now, during the Ludendorff offensives, he was armed with a pistol, and he captured 5 French soldiers. And for that, he received the Iron Cross First Class. And you didn't get those at any time in the war for free. You can't dismiss his decorations. He wins the Iron Cross Second Class in 1914, First Class in 1918. And then in mid-October, he got another battlefield decoration. But he's never promoted because he had a captain. Captain Fritz Wiedemann said he lacked the capacity for leadership. You just can't make those statements. As the war turned against Germany, he believed that the pacifists and the shirkers, which are people trying to get out of duty, were losing the war. And the thing that enraged him even worse is what is referred to as defeatism in the ranks. They're actually non-commissioned officers who said it was stupid to keep fighting. He beat one up. So we have a corporal beating up a non-commissioned officer and didn't get into trouble for it. He's a fanatic. The end of the war. Hitler was gassed by the British forces advancing near Ypres in mid-October 1918. It bloated his face up, and particularly his eyelids. Constantly watering eyes, had a hoarse voice. He then had this terrible pain. He referred to it, quote, piercing pain in my eye socket. He hated leaving the front to go to the hospital. He considered it the happiest chapter in his life. Being there, being something, being with people. You know, he had friends and he had comrades while he was in the war. He was not a loner. He had the respect of his fellow soldiers. He had purpose. By early November, Hitler's spirits had come back, and it was very common for people who had been gassed to plunge into depression because they're concerned about being blind the rest of their lives. On November the 9th, this is 2 days before the armistice, a local pastor came to the hospital and told the patients that on November the 8th that the Kaiser had abdicated and Germany was now a republic. And he told them that the war was lost.
Defeat was followed by a humiliating peace at Versailles. The injustice of Versailles rankled with most Germans for the next 20 years. Unable to accept that the German army had lost the war, Hitler convinced himself that the soldiers had been stabbed in the back by communist revolutionaries and parliamentary politicians. The stab in the back, he believed, was part of a great Jewish conspiracy. Suddenly, Hitler discovered the greatest talent he possessed, the gift of public speaking. He joined a small group of fanatical nationalists in Munich. They became the National Socialist German Workers' Party, or Nazis. In 1921, Hitler became their leader. The first film of the apprentice Führer campaigning shows him as still a rather awkward figure, not yet certain of his role as Germany's messiah. In 1923, Hitler felt strong enough to try and seize power in Munich. Emil Klein, the only stormtrooper still alive who marched with Hitler, now retraces their steps. Everything went well until the marchers found armed police blocking their exit from a narrow street.
Wir waren noch singend hier die Straße.
We were still singing as we marched down the street. And suddenly we heard shots being fired ahead of us. The procession stopped. We were speechless and couldn't explain what had happened. Until word came from the front of the march saying that Hitler was dead.
Ich sah Männer.
I saw men with tears in their eyes. And I myself was very moved too, and had great difficulty keeping myself under control.
Though Hitler in fact survived the hail of bullets, he was arrested and locked in a cell at Landsberg prison. At first he was so depressed he refused to eat. Then his confidence returned as he discovered that the failed uprising had made him a local hero. At the trial, Hitler rounded on his accusers. He told the judges who gave him a prison sentence, "History will tear to tatters the verdict of this court."
You have been accused of high treason and called an enemy of the state.
If I am guilty of anything, then I am guilty of fighting to defend the rights of the German.
Herr Hitler, court finds you guilty of treason. Hereby sentenced to a fine 200 gold marks and 5 years in Landsberg prison. You will be eligible for parole in 9 months.